I took 530 south from Little Rock to Whitehall in a nasty rainstorm, squinting through the windshield and passing judgment on travelers who would choose to work in the city and then squeeze together on a Friday afternoon racing to what looked to me like a few square miles of not a whole heck of a lot. I looked at the address of my destination, hastily scratched on an old receipt, and then pulled into the vet clinic. I told the woman at the front desk that I was there for Sassy. I was hesitant in anticipation of having to explain myself. Luckily, I didn't have to. The woman's eyes immediately watered up. "I'll just go get her, sweetie." She quickly returned with a Chinese Shar Pei so plump she had outgrown the thick creases and folds of her own skin. Her pink scarf and pink collar, along with her short, curled tail, made her look more porcine than canine. "Come on, gorgeous," I said, stroking her head. She oinked at me. "You'll need some help getting her in the car, I think," the woman said. "Let me come out there with you." It was a generous offer considering the storm. We struggled together to get Sassy into the car during the downpour. I felt relieved when she was finally settled and we were back on 530 North, aimed toward familiar territory. For a while, the only sound was the rain. Then there was a beeping. My car registered that Sassy was roughly the size of a fifth grader, and I feared that the vicious beeping was a rude warning that I did not have the promise of a competent caretaker. Sassy was never mine. She belonged to be a woman in her last few days of life after a long battle with cancer. I never knew B. We had never met, but a series of events had led me to be Sassy's in-between home until she was able to travel to a nice family up north who planned to adopt her permanently. It was a hard situation, one that caused me to be on the receiving end of text messages from a dying stranger who just wanted to know that her sweet Sassy dog would be okay. Providing her with that comfort felt good and cumbersome. We didn't relate very well, Sassy and me, and there was no reason why. I liked her well enough. She liked me well enough. Maybe I didn't want to grow too attached. More likely, though, I felt embarrassed that the temporary love I gave her could never rival the love she was used to in her old home that she must have missed in the way dogs miss things. Or perhaps Sassy and I were just like two folks who didn't have much in common. We were the kind of people who would bump into each other in the cereal aisle at the supermarket and, having nothing much to say, would fumble with our boxes of cornflakes until exchanging friendly smiles and eye contact again in the frozen food section. That was me and Sass, cohabiting the same small apartment, circling around each other, only I gave her the strained smiles while she gave me little grunts. One morning, Sass and I went for a walk. She seemed happy in spite of her breathing, which reminded me of my uncle's after climbing a staircase. My uncle has spent a lifetime enjoying nothing but Mountain Dew, Arby's roast beef sandwiches, and cigars. So I decided we should probably take a break on the curb. My neighbor, Miss Regina, came out to the edge of her fence to visit with us. She spends a lot of time tending to her garden, but if anything doesn't sprout as it should, she attaches silk and plastic flowers to branches and shrubs with twine as a means to force it into bloom. She also has a habit of asking me far too many questions for the distant neighbor relationship I strive to maintain. "New dog, it's fat," Miss Regina said. "Well, she isn't really my dog, I guess. I'm just looking after her." "Whose dog?" "Just someone who's sick and can't take care of her anymore. She's fat, too fat." Sassy snorted. My loyalty to Sassy swelled up. She may be an awkward friend you have to speak to in the grocery store, but she was mine all the same, at least for now. "That's why we're walking," I said. I wanted Sassy to choose this moment to strut instead of struggle down the street past all of Miss Regina's lemon-yellow daffodils tied to tree branches. As if daffodils even grow on trees. I wouldn't quite go so far as to describe Sassy's gait as a strut, but I don't think I was imagining things when I saw her chin lift a little higher when she sensed Miss Regina's gaze. "Atta girl," I said. I took her picture by the governor's mansion and sent it to B. I got a quick reply. "She always looks so angry, but don't worry, she's happy." A couple of weeks later, it was time to take Sassy to the parking lot of the Cracker Barrel, where a small bus would give her a lift up north. I put on all of her pink accessories and opened the car door. An old man walked by near the street corner. "Need some help, ma'am?" It was out of something resembling pride that I turned him down. He shrugged. I had already forgotten that her legs were too short to climb up, and she was too heavy for me to pick up. I sat on the curb to think of a strategy. I took a photo of Sassy and sent it to B. "All ready to go for her big adventure," I typed. It took me several tries to think what to say to this stranger who was losing her life and her dog. It made me sad to think that this woman was without Sassy at a time when she may have wanted her the most. I scratched Sassy's ears. She grunted at me. "Sorry," I said. I thought about running after that old man, but Sassy couldn't run, and I couldn't leave her. "What now?" she seemed to say to me with her big, gooey eyes. "I don't well know, do I?" I said back to her. Her bus would leave soon. I had to get her into my car. I thought about what they say about mothers finding superhuman strength in times of crisis and how their adrenaline can be pumping so hard that they are able to lift a car or a boulder off of a small child. If mothers can lift cars out of love, then surely I had enough love for Sassy to get her into one. I mustered up all of my strength and lifted that dog off the ground. I took another picture of her in the passenger seat and texted it to B, this time with no message. What could I say? That's when the beeping started again. I just have to deal with it until we got to North Little Rock. I turned up the radio in a poor attempt to drown out the noise, and I don't know if it was Huey or Lewis or the news who got to me, but I started to cry a little as the radio played, "Do you believe in love? Beep, beep. Do you believe it's true? Beep, beep, beep. Do you believe in love? Beep, beep, beep. Oh, you're making me believe it too. Beep, 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 beep." My phone buzzed. It wasn't B. It was a cousin saying she had passed away earlier in the morning. I started to cry a lot. We pulled into the parking lot. Everyone was waiting on us. "See you, Sassy." I kissed her on her head. She oinked at me. She was able to use the handicapped accessible entrance to mount the bus without me working up a sweat in front of a bunch of strangers and embarrassing us both. I hoped the family expecting a dog later that night would love her. I hoped that this dog, accustomed to a middle-aged woman dressing her up in pink outfits and overfeeding her, wouldn't be too disappointed. I hoped that Sassy's owner wasn't afraid or hurting or worried about her dog when she had died this morning. I wish I had sent her the picture sooner. I sat in my car until the bus drove away from the Cracker Barrel. Poor Sassy, poor B, poor all of us when we're lost or losing, and how lucky we sometimes get to at least be lost and losing together.